ourselves.
Welcome, I'm Jamil Smith. Thank you for joining us for 24 Hours of Reality. Protect our planet, protect ourselves. We know the truth. The climate is in crisis. Our health is at stake. We're standing at a crucial moment. Our fossil fuel dependency is creating dire pollution-related health consequences. Extreme weather, infectious disease, water and food scarcity, they're all taking tremendous tolls on the health of individuals, communities, and even economies. The situation is urgent, but there are solutions we can embrace today. From renewable energy to sustainable agriculture and forestry, low carbon transit and efficient buildings. For the next 11 hours, we will be exploring the powerful ways people are coming together to create real change. From fighting to shut down neighborhood coal plants right here in the United States, to creating entirely sustainable communities in Denmark. Travel with us tonight as former Vice President of the United States and the founder and chairman of the Climate Reality Project, Al Gore, leads the way around the globe. This year, we come to you live from the Los Angeles State Historic Park, situated in the area considered to be the birthplace of Los Angeles. In addition to being a beautiful setting along the Los Angeles River Greenway, this site marks a powerful community and environmental triumph, bringing the California State Parks mission to some of the most underserved communities in the nation's second largest city. From this space, Vice President Gore will join us to speak with world leaders like President Soli Niinistö of Scandinavia. We'll also be joined by passionate celebrities and will enjoy incredible musical performances. To see the full rundown of guests, visit 24hoursofreality.org. And now, for the next hour, we will continue our journey in Scandinavia and Nordic countries. During this broadcast, we'll be looking at several broad areas where the climate crisis and our dependency on fossil fuels are creating dire health consequences, including extreme weather, pollution, infectious disease, and food and water insecurity. Each of these are interconnected and have rippling effects beyond their initial health impact, such as mental health conditions from prolonged stress and PTSD, to climate conditions sparking conflict and violence, as well as displacement. Right now, we'll explore the relationship between the climate crisis and infectious disease with a short video hosted by Claire Danes. Take a look.
Our climate is in crisis. Our health is at stake. Cholera, Zika, malaria, these are diseases of our worst nightmares. Today's warming weather is creating perfect conditions for these infectious diseases to spread farther and faster than ever before. And it's all part of a bigger picture. Here's what the climate connection looks like. Climate change makes oceans, lakes, and other bodies of water warmer, which in turn allows pathogens like bacteria and toxic algae to thrive. The water we use to drink or bathe in or even play in can easily become a source of disease in these conditions. Millions of people around the world could be affected. While heat helps pathogens grow, extreme weather events like hurricanes and floods can spread them even further. And disease can spread through animals, like mosquitoes, that transmit viruses and bacteria directly through bites. When it comes to public health, mosquitoes are public enemy number one, killing more people each year than all human violence and all other organisms combined. Hotter temperatures mean that mosquitoes, ticks, and other carriers can survive and thrive in more places across Earth, living longer and reproducing faster. The result? Diseases like Lyme, dengue, and yellow fever can all increase their reach and spread more quickly than ever. These diseases affect us all, but like so many climate impacts, they hit people in developing nations hardest. We know what's driving this crisis. Burning fossil fuels fill the atmosphere with carbon pollution, warming our planet and changing our climate. The good news is that we know how to solve it and create a healthier future for everyone. Today, we can protect ourselves by powering our lives with clean and affordable renewable energy. In a world where our health is in the balance, the choice is clear. Protect our planet. Protect ourselves. Find out more at climaterealityproject.org.
Climate solutions start with you, which is why we want to hear your voice. Every hour, we'll be checking in to see how you're taking action and what your questions are on social media with actor and climate activist Kaylin Worthy, who is joined by model, social media personality, and climate reality leader, training attendee Stephanie Shepherd.
Welcome to the social media corner of 24 Hours of Reality. As you just heard, I have an amazing co-host for the next few hours, Stephanie Shepherd.
Thank you for having me. I'm so excited to be here.
Well, we are so excited to have you. Now, I just want to ask you, before we get into all the social media posts, what got you involved in the climate crisis? Why do you care?
I mean, how could I not care? I think I actually attended the Climate Reality Summit in LA this past year. And it just the more I learn, the more, you know, I care. And I'm just so excited to be here and to be a part of this.
Oh, well, that's fantastic. Well, we are so happy to have you here.
Thank you. You've been really killing it.
Oh, thank you.
You're going all night.
Oh, I care about
it. It's incredible.
I care about the issue. Now, if you're wondering what all these posts are, these are all posts from people just like you watching. They all use the hashtag 24 Hours of Reality on Instagram, Twitter, or Facebook. And their posts are now up here on the screen for the world to see. I want to point out a couple of them. We have this really fun one.
This is great.
She says...
This is what you looked like walking in today.
This is what I look
100%,
like? 100%,
yeah.
Because I'm so excited to be here.
So much energy. This was him this morning.
Well, she says, you know, walking and cycling instead of using motorized transport will keep you and the planet healthy. That is so true. And especially if you're walking like that, you burn even more calories. I want to point out one other one. We have... some delicious treats. Hey, there you go.
There's
some
Army
delicious treats. I mean, that's one of my favorite things is not only watching these watch parties happen all around the world, but also watching the snacks that you're eating because you guys have very good taste and a lot of them
snackers.
Are vegan and very healthy and very good for the planet. Now, if you want to have your post up on here, use the hashtag 24 Hours of Reality and you could have your post broadcast in front of the whole world to see. I'll talk to you guys soon.
And now, please welcome the President of the Republic of Finland, who will be joining former Vice President Al Gore for a conversation via satellite from Helsinki.
Our next guest is the President of the 12th President of Finland, just reelected earlier this year for a second six-year term. And President Niinisto, first of all, thank you for hosting me in your official residence last year in Helsinki. I really enjoyed that. Thank you so much. And before we talk about the issue of health and climate, I just think I have to ask you to get it out of the way, because it was global news when President Trump said something about raking the forest. And actually, you were talking with him about the surveillance system Finland uses to monitor the forest, but it appears that you and President Trump remember the conversation a little bit differently. What do you remember telling President Trump?
So, good afternoon. Yes, actually, we had a very good discussion. I started by asking about California, and then I told him that we here in North have had also problems. There were quite big forest fires in Sweden, in Russia, during the dry time in summer. And what was my idea was to enhance and sell him the idea that during our Arctic chairmanship, we will take up also the question how to prevent forest fires, because we in Finland have at least some knowledge about how to prevent that. And well, like I said, it was quite a good discussion.
Okay, well, evidently it got mistranslated in the way he recounted it, but we'll let that go. And I know there have been fires in the Arctic, and six of those big fires in Sweden this year were north of the Arctic Circle, so it's quite a problem. And Finland is now chairing the Arctic Council, which includes the U.S. and Russia and all of the Scandinavian countries and Canada. And you are focused on one element known as of the crisis called black carbon. A lot of people know it as soot. And it has a double impact because it settles on the ice and darkens the surface. And that absorbs more of the sun's energy, and so the ice melts more quickly. Tell me about the Arctic Council, its work, and what you hope to achieve as the chair of the Arctic Council.
Yes, Arctic Council has been working now for 20 years, and maybe unlike in other international institutions, we haven't met any major problems. The cooperation has gone quite well. Maybe it's due to the fact that when you're talking about Arctic and cool environment, you yourself also remain cool. But nevertheless, the cooperation has been very good, and we hope that to continue. That is why we have taken up also the issue of arranging for the first time Arctic summit with heads of states. I think we have a lot to do and a lot to discuss how we can save Arctic, because if we lose the Arctic, we lose the globe. That's so clear.
Yes, and this year, earlier in 2018, was the third year in a row that the North Pole started melting for a period during the middle of the cold polar winter night. No sunlight, but the disruption of the Northern Hemisphere jet stream brought very warm air right over the North Pole. And again, this is the third year in a row. But another reason why the ice is melting so rapidly there is that it is being covered by this dark soot or black carbon. What steps are the Scandinavian nations taking to reduce the emissions of black carbon?
You got it quite right. Surely the CO2 emissions and warming up of the climate, that is the major reason why Arctic is melting. But there is another reason, that is the black carbon we have taken up. Like you said, it's black carbon covering white snow. And after that meets sunshine, everybody understands that melting accelerates. And fighting first against this black carbon is our idea. Surely Paris agreements and Katowice, where I came yesterday, they are dealing with the climate change and warming up of the globe. But taking off the black carbon would have an immediate impact on how to prevent melting even further. So that is why it is, I think, very natural to talk in Arctic Council. Where it comes from? Well, flaring seems to be one of the major reasons. You know that in gas fields they burn extra gas, and that produces a lot of black carbon. But surely, specifically in Russia, they have old-fashioned energy plants which should be renewed. That might be even a business for somebody. And well, like I said, also these forest fires may produce a lot of black carbon. So in every means, we should get rid of that.
Yeah, definitely. And just as an aside, in the Himalayas, the so-called third pole, black carbon is an issue there as well. So your leadership of the Arctic Council can help to produce some solutions that have true global significance. I understand you've invited President Putin and President Trump to attend your meeting. Do you think they'll come?
First of all, thank you for telling me when you visited here. I guess this is a very familiar place to you.
Yes.
By taking up that the Arctic is not the only place where we suffer from black carbon, we try to keep that in mind too. Yes, we have invited, or let's say discussed, both in Washington and Moscow, whether the heads of states in USA and Russia would participate in a summit if we arrange one. And I have been actually slightly positively surprised that the problem of black carbon, it is clearly understood, and we have got at least so far positive comments on possible attendance to summit, but it's not sure yet.
Well, there's an old saying in the U.S.
I repeat once again that...
Go ahead.
Yep. Yeah, please.
Well, I was just going to say there's an old saying in the U.S., be careful what you pray for, but I yep. understand that it would be good for both of them to attend. And the flaring of gas, which produces a good portion of this black carbon, doesn't make any sense anyway, because it has a market value. Of course, I think we ought to stop burning all fossil fuels, including gas, but it should be recoverable.
Yep.
But speaking of ending the burning of fossil fuels as quickly as possible, I admire some of the steps Finland is proposing now to speed up the transition away from fossil fuels. Could you describe for me some of the things that Finland is proposing?
Yes, maybe I go a bit back to possible meeting of these presidents. How I see it is that if we can get further in black carbon issue, prevent black carbon, that would be a step forward for a whole environmental discussion. That is the basic idea. But what we are here in Finland doing, surely there are a lot of excuses to use fossil. We have a cold winter time, we have long distances, means a lot of traffic, but nevertheless, we are very decisive on making Finland a carbon neutral country up to 2045. And how we do it, surely the renewables are there, and unlike many other countries in Europe, we still are building nuclear power. That would be a kind of temporary bridge to the future. That's how we see it.
Yes, and of course nuclear power is controversial, but I think that, and we don't have time for a full discussion, but in the United States, we have some nuclear power plants that are proposed to be retired early. And there is a powerful argument to extend the lifetimes of those where the safety can be very much assured in order to reduce carbon emissions. I understand that. And Jim Hansen, one of our greatest scientists in the world, has been very eloquent in pushing that point of view. But now, this 24 Hours of Reality program, and again, it's such an honor for us to have you take part in it, we are focused on the connection between the climate crisis and health. And I know you have paid some attention to this, and of course, the air pollution that also results from burning fossil fuel is one of the implications, and heat stress. And I understand that this summer, the temperatures were so hot in Finland that some people actually went to sleep at night in the grocery stores near the refrigeration units in the grocery stores. So this is a very new experience for the Finnish people.
Oh, sure. Well, fortunately, the air in Finland is, according to international measures, it's the cleanest in the world, so breathing here is easy. But like you said, we had extraordinary warm summer, over 30 degrees heat day after day, and we are not used to that. So some of us, well, went to sleep in grocery store where the storekeeper was very polite to give room, and we have surely ice hockey rinks quite a lot, but it is a severe thing if people can't live like they are used to live because of the spoiling the climate.
Yes, last month I was invited to give the updated version of my slideshow on climate in Helsinki, and did research on the health impacts there, and they are quite surprising and quite real. But in the move to shift Finland away from fossil fuels, what is your biggest challenge in accomplishing that goal over time?
I already mentioned that we are warming our houses wintertime. We have long distances. So, you know, in that sense, we are heavy users. And that means that we have to do a lot to get rid of fossil fuels. But there are possibilities linked to renewables, linked also to new kind of thinking that maybe you don't have to use so much energy that you're used to do. So saving is also one element here.
And Scandinavia has been a global leader in innovating much higher levels of energy efficiency, including zero CO2 homes that are so tightly constructed that, as you say, you don't need the heating in winter, even though it's a very cold climate, particularly in the winter there. Now, I believe you've said you became more aware of the climate crisis almost 20 years ago. You had a wake-up call of sorts. Was that the Stern report by Lord Nick Stern? Did I read that correctly?
There were actually two gentlemen waking me up. First, I read the Stern report, and during that time I was more like an economist, and you know that economist believes to another economist.
Yeah.
Well, sometimes they disagree, but nevertheless. And the other gentleman, they call him Al Gore. I got familiar with your thinking and inconvenient truth. That was a good wake-up call. Thank you for that.
Well, you're very kind. Thank you so much. And before we go, this is not related to climate, but a lot of people outside of Finland don't realize you were actually a survivor of one of the big tsunamis when you were visiting with your son in Southeast Asia, and you had to climb a utility pole to escape alive. What was that like?
Well, I remember thinking while hanging there that the impossible has happened. There are 7 meters water behind us. And when impossible has happened, you ask yourself, where's the limit? Or is there any limit? And this is in connection to climate change. If we let impossible happen, there is no limits. What is the follow-up?
That's a very eloquent statement on which to end this interview. We are facing what some people thought was impossible, a global emergency that is an existential threat to the survival of our human civilization. So now, as you did during that tsunami, not climate related,
yes,
you had to immediately think of doing something you would not have believed possible in order to survive. So, Mr. President, congratulations on your leadership.
Yes.
I really admire what you're doing and the leadership you're providing. And thank you for being a part of this 24 Hours of Reality program.
Thank you so very much. And well, you're welcome to my residence whenever you visit Finland. Thank you so very much.
Thank you, sir.
We know the climate crisis and our dependency on fossil fuel has created a very real threat to public health. But there are individuals, businesses, and entire communities around the globe who are taking action to solve this crisis and create a healthier future for all of us. For example, back in 1998, the Danish government set out to prove that its goal of cutting carbon emissions by 21% was not only possible, but practical. What happened over the next 20 years is a remarkable story of a community coming together and creating far-reaching change. Take a look.
The whole green transition and climate change is people. It's about people. We set off to change from fossil fuel economy to a totally 100% green economy. We saw very early in the process that people came from outside, from abroad, to study what was happening here. We saw that we cannot just keep on being good for ourselves, we need to share that with the rest of the world. People want to look at Samsø as a model. We are not a model. The model is something you can use if you want to copy something. I want to have this as a reflection point where you say, maybe we can get some inspiration from Samsø. And then see what we have learned in Samsø and take elements of that and bring it into your own society and see how it works there. My name is Søren Hermansen, and I'm from Denmark. I'm from an island called Samsø. And Samsø is very central in Denmark. This is my island. I mean, this is maybe the most beautiful place on Earth, seen from my point of view. Samsø means meeting island. It's all the way back from the Viking period when people were sailing. It was a natural place to meet because when you cross from east to west in Denmark, you naturally pass Samsø. We had a minister in 1997 who was very ambitious, and he went to Kyoto and promised in Kyoto at the COP3 climate meeting that Denmark would cut down 21% of the present CO2 emission. Then he came home and he said, we need to prove that this is possible. So why don't we find a small community where it's not so expensive and risky to make this transition?
Suddenly the vision of the Samsø being a renewable energy arised, and I was like, oh, this is a totally nice job for you. And he was like, I'm not an engineer. And I said, yes, you are, you know, a farming engineer who knows a little about different practicalities. Your family has a good reputation, so it is possible for you to convince people.
I thought it was a little bit crazy, and I feared a little bit it was like hot air. But I felt it was my call, and I had to be there.
Nu var jeg sådan, at jeg var selv med til at bestemme, at det skulle udvikles. Jeg var med dengang, det blev søgt om tilskud. Så jeg har aldrig tøst, at jeg var tosset på noget tidspunkt.
I became the manager of the Energy Island project. And we set off to change from fossil fuel economy to a totally 100% green economy. And we had to do that in 10 years. The rest of the population was like rather, they didn't think much of it, just a crazy idea from a minister. The fear of change is embedded in people. We know what we have, we don't know what's in the future. To make this, to break this human resistant, you need to kind of invite to the in the process where people feel comfortable sitting down and talk about the unknown.
Of course we had some resistance, but we tried to invite people into our public meeting as early as possible to have the discussion and also use our energy democracy to make people a part of the decision making. Where should the wind turbines be built? How big should they be? Am I allowed to invest in them? And so on.
There's something about community here also. If you are a neighbor to a wind park, then you will be due to look at it every day. You will wake up in the morning and look at it, and it'll be in your sunset or in the sunrise or whatever. So it will be in your face all the time. If you don't own a share in this wind park, then you'll hate it, and you'll build a lot of resistance. If you're invited to participate as an owner or co-owner of the project, all of a sudden become yours. And when you wake up in the morning and you look at them spinning, then you think, wow, that's good. This is my doing. I'm part of this process, and it generates funds and money in my pocket. And I'm at the same time part of a green transition, which is good.
And then people go together and said, okay, I can put 10,000 into that and 10,000 into that. Small money, but with a big impact. So the mindset of people taking care instead of waiting for the government to take care. is a big shift in mind.
We had a normal carbon footprint in 1997 when we started the project. We were totally depending on imported fuel from outside, both electricity and oil for transportation and heating. House heating was imported from outside. We looked at how do we replace oil with something we can produce locally. When we did the math about technology and energy consumption, we could see that wind was pretty easy to cover because there's a lot of wind. So we erected 11 wind turbines, each one 1 megawatt. Then we made 4 district heating plants where you take away individual heating systems like little boilers, oil boilers in private houses, and you make 1 central boiler and then you pipe hot water around to a number of houses or villages. We started in January 1998, and in 2005 we could actually say we were carbon negative. So in 2008, 10 years after, we claimed that we were now 100% self-supplied. So it took 10 years. We don't have the emission from the oil boilers anymore. It's not there anymore. The particles and the unhealthy air pollution is gone.
Jamen, hvis det kommer noget og spørger det her, her har vi bevist, det kan lade sig gøre. Og det andet noget, hokus pokus, det er de ting, der er til rådighed, der er sat i gang for at få klar.
I've been the lucky owner of a windmill since August 2000, and that was a good thing in my life. It has been giving what I expected, and maybe a little bit more in some years.
I buy my energy from the next door neighbor now, from the farmer. I used to buy it from an oil sheikh from Saudi Arabia, but now I buy it locally. And I hope that the man who is selling me energy will use his money, his profit, to hire a carpenter to build his new house and stuff like that. So we have now raised the local economy balance and the capacity is so much stronger.
Suddenly people from all over the country and even from other countries started to take the phone and called us. Oh, what is going on this island? You are developing a bunch of things. Can we come and visit you?
And I very soon realized that, hey, we are not alone in this transition. And we need to reach out and make a network of hubs that will follow this lead. So my responsibility was to go out there and help them.
There's an opening here in the timing.
Yes.
My life today is a lot about exchanges. And I'm invited to go to many different communities around the world where they face the same kind of challenge of local innovation and local development as we do. All right, how many is from South America? Wow, that's a lot.
I think it's very wise that Søren travels the world because it's a very good story. And he isn't telling the story from himself, but he is telling it for the people on his island.
My interest as a businessman is to understand how they did it, but more interesting, is it possible to scale this? Is it possible to use this lessons learned in Denmark, but even abroad Denmark, around the world? Are there other areas, islands for example, where this technology could be deployed?
What Søren did on the island is to make people part of the energy system, literally. They make money when there's energy generated. I think that's very important to involve other people in the energy system. And why? Because the energy system is going to be everywhere. We have windmills, solar panels. We are basically living in a factory. And some people think that's bad, but if you offer them a piece of that, then you can give them an advantage. And I think that changes the perspective.
My hopes is that what we set off to do and what we started up doing will continue. I think it's an eternal effort to keep on trying and doing new things here also and break the traditional thinking and get into new paradigm. And I think sometimes we need to kind of get outside, break the wall down and do something crazy that'll take us to another place or another dimension. So my passion, I think my passion is to make that happen.
Thank you.
Each year, 24 Hours of Reality brings the world together for one full day to talk about the reality of the climate crisis and how we can solve it. Today, you can become a citizen producer of this live broadcast and have your name appear in the closing credits. Don't miss your chance to support this world-changing broadcast. Visit 24hoursofreality.org to learn how. Our next guest is the director designate of the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research and a professor of environmental science at Stockholm Resilience Center. His work on global sustainability issues has gained him international recognition. Please welcome Dr. Johan Rockström, who joins former U.S. Vice President Al Gore via satellite in Berlin.
Johan, thank you so much for joining us. I've told you in person on many occasions that I really admire your work. You are one of the very leading voices in the world in synthesizing the many fields of science that relate to the climate crisis and its solutions. So thank you for joining us. It's a great honor to have you. When I give slideshows on the causes and solutions of the climate crisis, I always make a point to emphasize that agriculture is a part of the crisis, and we have to move towards sustainable agriculture, particularly in animal agriculture. You have been making the point that, yes, fossil fuels are the single largest source of the global warming pollution, but we now, it's not just about fossil fuels. We have to move beyond the conversion to renewable energy, which is beginning, but we've got a lot of work to do. Tell us why you are placing such a great emphasis on food and agriculture.
Yeah, to start with, it's wonderful to join this incredibly important initiative. So I'm humbled to have the honor to join with you, Vice President Al Gore. So thanks a lot. And you know, we have scientific evidence today to show that the final battleground, whether we fail or succeed with the Paris Agreement of keeping global warming below 2 degrees Celsius, is no longer whether we're able to decarbonize the world's energy system, a grand challenge in its own right, but whether we're able to transform the global food system to become a net carbon sink over the next 50 years. But it has to start as an agricultural revolution now. And why is this? Well, to start with, we know that the food system is the single largest emitter of greenhouse gases if you compare different sectors in society. Roughly 17% of the global emissions originate from land use change and our livestock systems around the world, and an additional 15 to 17% originates from deforestation and land system change when we encroach on natural ecosystems by expanding agriculture, everything from soya to palm oil to beef production in rainforest areas. So overall, almost a third. But additional to this, we have the intensive use of fertilizers, intensive mechanized and transport systems. So, you know, the fossil fuel burning and nitrous oxide and the whole land system change makes agriculture a dominant source of forcing of the climate system. Added to that is that agriculture is the single largest consumer of fresh water, the single largest cause behind loss of biodiversity, and the single largest dominant cause behind land system change. So overall, you get things right on agriculture, you stand a good chance of getting the world back on track within a safe operating space that in turn will enable us to have a transition to a safe and stable climate system.
Yeah, excellent points. And many people are not aware that the synthetic nitrogen fertilizer that we started using over 100 years ago and is now dominant in agriculture is made from natural gas. 90% of it is natural gas, and it's like steroids for crops. And 7 to 8 pounds of plant protein are needed to make 1 pound of animal protein. So the growing meat intensity of diets in the world complicates this fact. We'll be originating from Brazil in a few hours, and I'm troubled, as many are, of the new president of Brazil's plans to accelerate the destruction of the Amazon, largely for more cattle ranching in poor soils that are not productive anyway. So if we can transform these systems of agriculture, we can make it net negative on carbon. That's what you're saying. We can actually recarbonize the soil I think there are two or three times as much carbon in the topsoils as in all the forests put together. How can we recarbonize the soils and do it in a way that benefits farmers as well?
Yeah, to start with, you're absolutely right when referring to the challenges, for example, with the president-elect in Brazil, with Bolsonaro, that, I mean, we have a broken food system. We have, soya production cultivated by deforesting rainforest, which then is transported across the world as feed into intensive food meat production systems, which then is shipped into consumption in cities that then leads to waste, which eutrophies our waterways and destroys local ecosystems and leads to emissions of nitrous oxide, which is a fierce greenhouse gas. So we have a system that simply just breaks the Earth's life support systems from biomes to the climate system. And we have to change this fundamentally. Now that's the absolute challenge. The good news is that we have, as you indicate, a lot of practical solutions here. I was together with a whole group of scholars just recently published a paper led by Professor Jules Pretty in the UK showing that 29% of farming systems around the world have started to transition towards different forms of sustainable intensification. And for carbon, what every farmer knows is that more carbon you have in the topsoil, the better is your water holding capacity, the less soil erosion do you have, and better microbial activity do you have to regenerate nutrients and productivity in your root zone for your crops. Which means that fundamentally there's such an enormous win-win here that yeah. If we can transition towards practices of conservation tillage, which means abandoning plowing, because what is often forgotten is that the mechanized modern agriculture, where we turn the soil every year as a way of preparing land for planting, is the largest single cause behind burning of carbon from agricultural land. You expose it to water, you expose it to solar energy, which means that you oxidize your carbon and lose it back to the atmosphere. Right. Now, if you don't touch that soil and try to copy nature in terms of building organic matter and having direct zero plowing farming systems, which we have technologies to perform, you can both build carbon in the soil, have better water holding capacities, and have better productivity. Why did we in the first place develop the plow? Well, it was largely because of a weed management tactics to be able to expand the area of our cultural cropping. And we have today technologies to avoid just jumping on the herbicide bandwagon and instead using more, diverse crop rotations and different management systems to reduce weed pressure. So there are pathways to transition from an agriculture that's today is a carbon source to becoming a carbon sink.
Yeah, I remember as a young boy learning from my father in Tennessee on our family farm how to identify the richest, most fertile soil. It was black, as he told me, and showed me, and it was usually moist. But it was a long time after that yes. I learned the reason why it's black. That's the carbon. And in the American Midwest, there is a small but growing farmer-led movement to adopt the techniques that you've described. And during the recent climate-related droughts and ill-timed downpours during planting or harvesting, these farmers are actually doing better economically than those that are still using the old industrial agriculture model, which strip mines the topsoil. For every kilogram of grain grown in the Midwest, several kilograms of topsoil go out down the Mississippi River and into the Gulf of Mexico, carrying with them nutrients and fertilizers that actually are responsible for these dead zones. So this is a very big challenge. And how do you talk to farmers who are skeptical about making this transition? Have you had that experience?
Actually, yes. I was part of starting the conservation tillage initiative in East and Southern Africa many years back. I've had the privilege to work with researchers and farmers in action research in Latin America, where you see you know, really exciting scaling technologies being adopted, for example, on manure and green, basically totally zero tillage green manure type systems where you're building organic matter and managing weeds by having permanent different forms of green manuring crops that cover the soil. And in Africa, we have, for example, in Tanzania, when I was working there in Arusha, an enormous skepticism when we were suggesting that you now is the time to consider throwing away the plow and simply instead adopting what we called rippers and subsoilers that simply just open the soil and where you can have precision farming. But, you know, it didn't take us long, particularly working with female farmers, where they realized that they could make money out of this, because if you, instead of plowing the whole field, where farmers then normally go and widespread throwing out fertilizers with that are extremely expensive, instead just open the soil for the planting and have precision application of your precious nitrogen and phosphorus, that enabled, you know, instead of basically fertilizing even the weeds, you could focus in a way that in the end enabled yields to improve and incomes in households to rise. And today, you see that conservation tillage systems, building organic carbon, but also using really, really finite resources of fertilizers much, much more carefully, is a kind of a mainstream practice. Now, we need this to become a revolution at a really large scale, but you see, you know, this is no longer just pilots. That's what we showed in this research article. We're starting to see a spread across the world. And the interesting thing is, it's not about reducing your productivity, it's about sustainable intensification. It's about wise management of water, land, soils, and nutrients to be able to produce more food and better food without doing it at the expense of the climate system and of natural ecosystems.
I wish we had more time, Johan, but we're going to have to wrap up this interview. I would just like to close where I began by saying thank you for the extraordinary work you're doing. And next month, I know you're launching a new Lancet Commission. We've talked about the Lancet Commission on Health and Climate, and you're launching one focused on quantitative targets for the food system. Everyone wishes you luck with this new initiative. Keep up your fantastic work, and thank you so much for joining us for this 24 Hours of Reality initiative.
Well, I'm grateful, and likewise, good luck, and thank you very much. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
And now let's check back in with Caleb Worthy and Stephanie Shepherd to see what you've been saying on social media.
Hey, guys. Welcome back to the Social Media Corner.
We are so excited because, I mean, social media is blowing up right now with the hashtag 24 Hours of Reality, all because of you. So we really would love to point out some of our favorite posts over the last few minutes since we last spoke. We have a really fun one. This is a party and a huge event that they're holding for 24 Hours of Reality. They're broadcasting it on a giant screen for the whole area to know. So fun.
So fun. Oh, we love this. We love a climate reality selfie. I think we need to take a climate reality selfie.
I completely agree. And we would also love you to also take a climate reality selfie as well. And if you do, there's a chance that your face could be up here with us. Now, we also have some climate reality leaders as well. Now, if you're wondering what that is, I am a climate reality leader, and so are you, Steph, as well.
Yes.
I got my training in Iowa in 2015.
I went this year in LA.
And it is a fantastic program. You get the skills and you get the information to talk about the climate crisis with your community on social media and with your family, friends, and even do presentations of your own with the slideshow. It's a fantastic program.
Yes.
It really changed my life.
I think we need to go back. They're having one in March.
That's right.
I believe it's in Atlanta, so I think we should probably go.
We definitely should. And for more information, check out Climate Reality Project on social media or go to their website as well. Now, we really want to continue to hear from you. We want you to be a part of the conversation. So use the hashtag
24 Hours of Reality.
That's right.
Show us your posts. We're going to literally walk right off here, check our phones, see what everybody's up to, and hopefully
it's
you'll get to see yours up here.
Exactly. Tell us why you care about the climate crisis, and tell us what you do to help the planet as well, and maybe even post one of those selfies.
Over the last hour, we've spent time getting to know some of the health challenges faced by the people of Scandinavia and Nordic countries. We've explored the many ways people are taking action to solve the climate crisis and create a healthier and more sustainable future for us all. And remember, you are the most powerful advocate for your health. As we've seen, we stand at a crucial moment in the climate crisis. And today, as the leaders of the world gather in Poland to once again review their commitments, it is more important than ever that we urge them to take the strongest possible action required to ensure a healthy future for us all. Go to 24hoursofreality.org, where you can share the news and insist upon urgent action now. Or if you are in the United States, you can text CLIMATE to 40649 to get started. When we protect our planet, we protect ourselves.
Hello, my name is Serge Tankian from the band System of a Down. Man-made climate change is an irrefutable fact. Those who deny it deny science and truth. The climate crisis is an existential one for all humanity, one that requires the cooperation of us all. Ignorance and unawareness are the only true enemies here. We must take up the challenge of working to reverse, if not reduce, the effects of man-made climate change onto ourselves for the sake of our children and grandchildren. That means vigilant action to reduce greenhouse gases, both on personal and societal levels. It also means opposing irresponsible harvesting of energies and reduction of pollution. Are we up to it? We better be. All of our lives depend upon it.
Hi there, this is Robin. Today, climate crisis is affecting people all over the world. And while most of the world's leaders have agreed to act, we've had setbacks. Every single one of us can help to continue the momentum to build a better society for everyone, a more fair one, a more clean one. And one of the things you can do is join me at 24hoursofreality.org and demand your leader to act to protect the planet.
It started out as a climate crisis. It's become the greatest health crisis we've ever seen. You've watched it happening, first in the headlines, today maybe right outside your window. The world's getting warmer, and heat waves are turning lethal. Storms are getting stronger, putting millions of us in harm's way. Diseases are spreading farther and faster. If you're a farmer, plant diseases and pests are showing up sooner and hanging around longer every season. Rainfall patterns are changing. Food and clean water are getting harder to come by. It's all connected, and it all goes back to our burning coal, gas, and oil, fossil fuels. We're taking ancient carbon and putting it in the air. We're producing greenhouse gases that are heating up the Earth's land and ocean. As temperatures rise, dangerous heat waves, droughts, and wildfires are happening more and more often. Things are changing faster than we can deal with them. Lakes and rivers are both drying out and flooding. Crops are withering or drowning. We can't grow them where we've been growing them for centuries. Warmer seasons mean mosquitoes can carry diseases like Zika and malaria more quickly. And the extra heat throws the water cycle out of balance, leading to more powerful storms and floods and droughts everywhere from Florida to the Philippines. Meanwhile, fossil fuels also fill our air, water, and soil with toxic chemicals that make us sick, causing everything from asthma to brain dysfunctions that last a lifetime. And this, by the way, is really bad for our kids. If you think it adds up to a more dangerous and unhealthy planet for all of us, you're right. But here's the good news. It doesn't have to be this way. Today, we can skip the dirty stuff and protect our health by powering our lives with affordable, clean energy. Best of all, a clear majority of people around the world want to do just that. It's time to act. After all, our health is in the balance. The choice is clear. Protect our planet, protect ourselves.
Climate is in crisis. The signs are all around us. The stakes are high. A healthy future hangs in the balance. Join us for a journey around the globe as we examine how we all are being affected by the growing climate health crisis and what businesses, leaders, artists, and everyday people are doing to solve it. This is 24 Hours of Reality. Protect our planet, protect ourselves.